Today's quote is, how do I buy stock in all those grocery store social distancing floor stickers? We'd make a fortune. Yesterday and today, we come to the end of John chapter 6. We heard that the crowd quarreled among themselves. They murmured among themselves. It's the same word used in the Old Testament when the Israelites murmured because all they had to eat was the manna in the desert. So it's the same word of grumbling and murmuring among themselves because Jesus had said, I am the bread of life. Unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life within you. And they said, well, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? They took Jesus literally. Jesus spoke literally. And not only that, he kept repeating himself 3, 4, 5 times, kept repeating the same thing, and each time getting more literal and more graphic each and every phrase that he said. If Jesus were speaking metaphorically, if he was speaking figuratively, he would have explained it. He would have said, no, don't take me literally. I'm only speaking symbolically about eating my flesh and drinking my blood. I'm only speaking figuratively or metaphorically. But Jesus did not do that. And yet Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus can only teach the truth. When somebody questioned him, he would always explain the true answer. For example, when he told Nicodemus, unless you're born again of water and the Holy Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Nicodemus said, well, how can I climb back into my mother's womb and be born over again? Nicodemus took Jesus literally, saying, how can I climb back inside my mother's womb? Jesus said, no, I'm referring to be born again of water and the Holy Spirit. The Lord is referring to baptism. When Jesus said, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees, the disciples thought he was talking about they forgot to bring bread along. They took Jesus literally. Jesus explained, no, beware of the evil plots of the Pharisees. So Jesus would always explain if somebody misinterpreted what he meant. Where in this case, when they said, well, how can you give us his flesh to eat? He did not say, well, I'm just referring to accepting my teachings or accept me as your personal savior. Jesus did not do that. He kept repeating, literally, this is what I mean. And he even takes it a step further. He says, amen, amen, which means truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, he even now adds the drinking of blood, which for the Jews was reprehensible because they wouldn't even eat animals which had blood in it still. And he says, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, and the word eat here is gnaw, consume, chew. It's a very graphic word, a very strong word. It's even stronger than previously. So he gets not less symbolic, he gets more realistic. And drink his blood, you do not have life within you. The Greek is zoe, eternal life, the life of God, the divine life. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. I will raise him up on the last day. Again, the Eucharist is the food for immortality. And then he says, my flesh is true food, my blood is true drink. Not my blood is representative, not symbolic. My flesh is true food, my blood is true drink. Again, he says, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. He who feeds on me will have life because of me. Again, very strong language having to do with chewing and gnawing upon the flesh and blood of Christ. And that's why it says, many of the disciples of Jesus who were listening to this said, this is a hard saying, who can accept it? In Greek, it doesn't mean who can understand it, because they understood what Jesus meant, but who can actually accept it? Who can believe in it? We understand what he's saying, but who can actually accept it? This is a very hard saying. And it says they continued to murmur about this. Again, that word from the Old Testament crowd. Well, then Jesus explains, what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? So he's referring here to, I will prove that what I say is true because I'm going to rise from the dead and even ascend to heaven. I came down from heaven. Now I'm going to go ascend back to heaven. It is the Spirit that gives life. while the flesh is of no avail, the words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. Some of the commentators say, well, here Jesus is saying he's only speaking spiritually. He's not speaking literally, because he says the words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. Well, they say, well, spirit does not mean real. That, of course, does not make sense, because God is spirit and God is real. Angels are spirits and they are real. Spiritual does not mean unreal. This word, what Jesus was saying all about eating his flesh and drinking his blood, requires God's grace to accept it. It requires the gift of faith to accept it. If you look at it from a purely human, fleshly point of view, that will bring you no avail. You have to look at it with God's grace and accept it as the truth, because it is revealed by God, who is truth. And yet, then Jesus says, some of you are with me who do not believe. And then the gospel concludes by Jesus saying that, John says, Jesus knew from the beginning the ones who would not believe and the one who would betray him. Here is the first evidence that Judas would betray the Lord, and it had to do with not accepting the Eucharist. So as Bishop Sheen says, that was the crack in Judas's priesthood, not accepting the Eucharist. That's where he started to leave the Lord. And it ends with, as a result of this, and this is shocking, many of his disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer walk with Jesus. The Lord probably had hundreds of disciples at this time, hundreds of them. Remember, he had already sent out like 72 disciples earlier. Besides the 12, he had hundreds of disciples, those who would listen and sit at the feet of Jesus. Jesus lost every single follower of his, hundreds of them probably, except the 12. And even then, notice what Jesus didn't do. He did not call them all back and says, you know, all you hundreds of people, come back. I didn't mean literally eat my flesh and drink my blood. I only meant it symbolically. But Jesus let them all go. Imagine that. Imagine giving a sermon where the entire church walks out except the deacon and the altar boys, right? And are you guys going to leave me as well? You know, that's how powerful this was when Jesus spoke this. He let them all go. A true teacher would have said, no, come on back. You misunderstood me. Jesus preached it. They understood it, but they could not accept it. And then Jesus even turns to the 12 and says, do you want to leave me also? And it's Simon Peter, the first pope, who speaks up and says, Master, where shall we go? There's nobody else to follow. You alone have the words of eternal life, and we have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God. Notice St. Peter and these 12 disciples, these 11 disciples, did not perfectly understand how Jesus could give them his flesh to eat. That would occur at the Last Supper when they finally understood, when Jesus took bread and wine and said, this is my body, this is my blood. Then they understood how we can eat his flesh and drink his blood. Notice the disciples did not completely understand, but they accepted it. And that's the key. They accepted it even without the full understanding.